organic growth will take a hell of a lot, a long time, you know, for it to achieve size, reach, you know, expand our franchise. I would think the future growth of the bank must be through M&A, and I think that must the real answer to your question. Otherwise, it will take years. In the future, us doing more investment banking work as well, fund management, for example. Let's say Zakat fund management or Wakaf fund management. Zakat is a compulsory tax, Islamic tax. The collection has not been very good across the Islamic communities in the world. Of course, the collection is best, say, in a place like Saudi Arabia. In Saudi Arabia, if we use Saudi Arabia as a base for calculation of what could be collected in terms of Zakat contributions, some people have come up with the number of $100 billion a year, 100 billion. If you have such a sizable fund every year and you could put it under management worldwide, of course, just imagine, you know, how much return you can give to the community, you know, on that investment. So, I mean, these kind of bigger picture areas, I think we should be looking at in terms of investment banking side. So M&A and investment banking. The air is crowded. Everyone's into Islamic banking now. You know, it's become flavor of the month, so to speak, and also a lot into retail, you know, consumer banking. So there is a squeeze in terms of yields. At the same time, deposit rates have gone up in Malaysia. So we have this double whammy coming in, more people coming in, yields coming down, deposit costs going up, and then everyone's trying to shift the deposit base. You know, they're looking at, you know, CASA, consumer and savings accounts because of lower cost. But I'm sure as everyone concentrates on CASA, there will be higher costs coming up as well there. So it is a tight market, and therefore, you know, the kind of size that I think we should achieve and the kind of diversification that we should look for is a strategic way of trying to make sure we have other sources of income as this main consumer-driven source, individual or wholesale, gets a yield squeeze, you know, and so there is a squeeze. In a way, the failure of conventional banking, you know, conventional finance, and whilst one should not be crowing about it, it does give you a certain leg up, you know, and I think hence many people are going into, you know, Islamic banking even abroad. I mean, the largest fund management center for Islamic funds is actually London, for example, and essentially it's a commercial opportunity insofar as the non-Islamic countries, Islamic finance activities are concerned. I mean, I think their main eye is on Middle Eastern funds, you know, to come in for them to manage. But it grows. So, you know, there are trends. But I don't take a holier-than-thou approach about Islamic finance, and some people tend to be a bit like that. I don't believe it should be like that. I would rather take a kind of a better-than-thou approach. Compete, do better, offer you know, better products and so on. And at the same time, understand that Islamic finance is just not for Muslims. And when you take a holier-than-thou approach, you constrict it and you put off non-Muslims. You put them off, and I don't believe in that. I think we should get modernized, and this is one of the things I would like to see happen in this bank as well. You know, so that approach, that thinking must also change. If you want to make real inroads, then you begin to make a very structural change that can come about. And in Malaysia now also, as another advantage of government support, Islamic banking and finance is no longer a complementary form of financing. It was an alternative complementary form. This is financing in its own right now. So it's come of age, you know, reached some kind of adulthood. Western financial crisis, note I use Western financial crisis, not global financial crisis, has been a disaster for the world, with global implications in terms of economic crisis, because you know, the drying up of available funds, investment funds, is a curse to the world, and obviously has had an impact. The 08, 09 crisis did have an impact, but it was somewhat well handled. One of the impacts was in the export finance market, so there was no export finance available, and therefore importers could not import the exports from this region, and so it had, you know, it had that impact. But the Chinese stimulus package then did help to lessen, you know, that impact. But now you're getting a second round, you know, with the European Eurozone crisis, and then we're at the thin end of the impact of the Chinese stimulus package, and then of course Europe has not. It's likely to be in a mild recession, and U.S. is bobbing along at about 3% or so, and China's having little jitters, and some people say set for a soft landing, and the final markets are still Europe, U.S., Japan, and China has developed into a great market, but there was still this need for the finished products, whether, you know, the exports came from Taiwan or Korea or Malaysia. There was a final market which is now weak. So Malaysia is affected by that. And if you look at the Malaysian numbers, 2010, we did like 7-odd%. But 2011, you know, we came down to 5-odd%. And 2012, we are looking at, of course, government would like to say 4-5%, but I think we might be looking at the lower end of 4%, you know, the lower end of it, 4.1-4.2%. Obviously, the export demand has had an impact. However, there's been countervailing effort to increase domestic demand and also public sector consumption and investment to alleviate the impact of you know, the lessening external demand. Therefore, there is this consequence on the Malaysian economy. At the same time, government is very conscious of this. So it has all these very sort of swish, smart plans. Two areas I think is quite important to look at. One, they have this Kuala Lumpur Klang Valley improvement projects. A lot of it infrastructure-driven, improving sewerage systems, you know, improving quality of life, transportation system in Kuala Lumpur. There's a lot of money to be invested and to be made from these kinds of projects in Kuala Lumpur. I think people should look and see where they can find these sort of things. And then the other one is, of course, in the Iskandar region, you know, the Iskandar development region. And here I would pick out education, you know. I would pick out medical, what they call it, medical tourism. I don't like that term, but, you know, medical-related things, people come. And there's a lot of synergy here with Singapore. And Singapore, as they go up the ladder, they're passing down to Iskandar some of the things they have been doing before. And so this we can take. You know, take up. So let's look at that region, look at tourism, look at education, look at medical science, hospitals and that kind of stuff. That's another area. So that's two physical areas with some potential sort of actual business investment possibilities. And then overall across the country, I think the agricultural sector, I would say, and oil and gas. Now, agricultural sector, you're talking about plantation sector, you're talking about oil palm industry. You're not talking about putting money, just planting more palm, oil palm, but you're also talking about moving up the ladder. Technologies that will reduce the gestation period of the palm. Technologies that will develop biofuels from the palm oil.